was enlightenment for humanity. So I was forced to. They gave me a deadline as well, a bit like some of your students. For the first time in about 50 years, I had a deadline. And it was a bit daunting, really. Of course, I didn't manage it. First of all, the deadline was just a few days after they asked me, and I very bravely said yes. And then, thankfully, a few days later, they wrote to me, they emailed me and said, oh, I had another week, which sounded a lot better. And it was to be the Monday before I went. Well, I managed to get it on the Tuesday, so not too bad, really. Anyway, it was a bit of a first time I've written 5,000 words for a year. I normally just talk like this and hope for the best. But suddenly I had to write this paper, 5,000 words. Anyway, I did it. And then I forgot all about it until the night before I had to talk. I had a quick look at it and practically sight read it on the day. But it went all right. Anyway, but it was about, I had to think about it. The benefits of the Buddha's enlightenment. And I thought to myself, well, first of all, there's obviously benefits to the Buddha himself. That's clear. We all know that if we improve ourselves, then we benefit just as the Buddha benefited by achieving his enlightenment. But then, it's all very well, people will say, what about everyone else? And I thought to myself, well, if the Buddha attained his enlightenment and did feel so much better and was clearly then possessed of a mind which was free of greed, hatred and delusion, then his effect on those around him would be quite extraordinary. And we can read in the scriptures that this was so. The people meeting the Buddha were just bowled over by him. And the most extraordinary example is that of Angulimala, which, as you know, is a story that I love to tell because of my involvement in the prison. But it's also a story that many people find almost incomprehensible, because he appeared to be such a terrible and evil person. How could he possibly change? How could meeting the Buddha have such an effect? But then I thought to myself, I meet people in the jails, both prisoners and staff, who are very sort of macho and often angry and aggressive. And when they're met with aggression, they know how to handle that. But when you smile at them and you're nice to them, they don't quite know what to do. And I thought to myself, well, if this terrible man, intent on murdering Angulimala, suddenly met the Buddha, who was completely unfazed by him, had no aversion for him, no dislike of him, no fear of him, then clearly he wouldn't know what to do. And that appears to be the case. Angulimala was just totally disarmed by the effect of this amazing person who, unlike most people, had no hatred of him and no fear of him, and just stood there quietly and totally unarmed, smiling at him. His swords and weapons dropped from Angulimala's hands. And he quite calmly went back with the Buddha to the monastery, where, of course, we know he attained enlightenment. And that story is a powerful one, because it also reminds us that people change, can change, that we all, in fact, have this potential to be somewhat like the Buddha. We can all free our minds from greed, hatred, and delusion. So I thought about this, and I thought about the effect of the Buddha on those around him, without saying a word, without giving any teaching, without writing up anything, not even 5,000 words. People were changed by his presence. But then, of course, we know the Buddha did teach, and he was a very dedicated teacher. We know that he taught for a very long time. He didn't have to. He could have just enjoyed his enlightenment, gone off somewhere, and had quite a peaceful and pleasant time. But he gave up that, the wonder of the highways and byways of northern India, northern central India, teaching and preaching and advising just about anyone who came to him. And all sorts of different kinds of people did come to him. The rich came to him, the princes and the kings. They came to him for advice. They didn't always know what to do, and they with the problems they had, so they came to see the Buddha. And I guess being a king can be a pretty stressful occupation sometimes, and so they took some relief from being in the presence of the Buddha. And the poor came to him, the road sweeper, all sorts of people came to the Buddha, and he taught them very patiently. He taught them. And, you know, it reminds me when I was with Ajahn Chah, I used to sit there sometimes at his kuti. We had to always be there to attend on him. And it was very hard work, really, sitting there, while lots of people, a whole procession of people all day long, would come to see him. And they'd sit in front of him, and they, of course, just wanted to be in the presence of the great man. And then they would talk, and they'd gossip, and they'd tell him about their problems, and this, that, and the other. A lot of rubbish, really. And Ajahn Chah used to sit there, patiently listening to it all. But every so often, there was an opening. They'd say something about, you know, a particular problem they had, or something that had happened to them. And when there was a chance, he was in, and teaching them some real tamma, not book tamma, but tamma about their experience. Because that's what Buddhism is about. It's about our experience. It's what we experience. We experience suffering, and we can experience the results or effects of our craving and attachment. We experience it. It's not theory. It's there in our everyday life. And Noppo Chah was brilliant at talking real tamma to people about their everyday experience. And that's, of course, what the Buddha did. He didn't sit there spouting the scriptures. He talked to people, and when there was an opportunity, he advised them. And he told them quite particularly where they were going wrong. And all the time, it was pointing back into their own minds, their own inner attitude. And he tried to do the same. He didn't... Sometimes he gave discourses, it's true. It's traditional to do that, and he could talk for hours. Don't I know it? I've sat there for hours on end, not understanding a word. So I know he could talk for a long time. And his talks, for those who could understand them, were clearly brilliant and entertaining as well as informative. But I think the most important thing was how he would teach people individually from their experience. And I've seen him sitting there with people who really weren't terribly interested in it. I remember one day in Bangkok, we were at some rich person's house. We went to a wheeled in to sit in the house. And the people were not that interested in him, really, and he didn't seem to be that interested in them. And then they told their son to come and pay his respects. And the boy had a question. And suddenly, Ajahn Chah sort of lit up, and all his focus was on that boy, teaching that boy. And I looked around and I saw these rich people who would get sort of fed up because Ajahn Chah was not taking any notice of them. He was talking to the boy because the boy was interested. And the boy had some real experience to relate and that Ajahn Chah could relate to and enlarge upon and help him. So the Buddha did this. He wandered about, people came to him, all sorts of people. All sorts of different kinds of problems and difficulties. And he taught them. And he gave them a way out of their suffering. Now this, of course, is the most important benefit of the Buddha's enlightenment. This was the first thing that I really thought about. Had the Buddha not attained enlightenment, we wouldn't be sitting here. We'd have no Buddhism. You know, now we have this amazing... thousands, millions of people throughout the world. Different kinds of Buddhism, a great family of separate but related movements, all of which have one thing in common. They all have as their origin the Buddha's enlightenment. And without that enlightenment, we wouldn't have this great family. And most especially, we wouldn't have a way out of our suffering. And if we didn't have that, We'd be living a life without hope. We'd be